So good morning everyone and welcome to this session on facial nerve. The facial nerve is the seventh cranial nerve, as all of us know. Now this is how we describe a cranial nerve. The cranial nerve has to be described under these headings. Firstly, we talk about the functional component. In the functional component, we talk about the component. Then we talk about the nucleus, which contributes to this component, fibers for this component, then the area of supply. Then we talk about the nuclei, which are the various nuclei of the cranial nerve. Then we talk about the intraneural course of the nerve. Then we talk about where the nerve appears on the brainstem. Then we talk about the intracranial course. Then we talk about the exit from the skull. Then the extracranial course and the branches. And lastly, the applied anatomy. With this background, let us start studying the cranial nerve with these headings. So firstly, the functional components. These are the functional components of the facial nerve. The facial nerve has special visceral efferent component. The facial visceral efferent component is a component which a cranial nerve has if it supplies the muscles developing from pharyngeal arches. The facial nerve supplies the muscles developing from the second pharyngeal arch. Therefore, it has this component, special visceral efferent. And general visceral efferent is a component which a cranial nerve will have whenever it has when it is a part of the parasympathetic outflow, the cranial component of the parasympathetic outflow. So the fibers for the special visceral efferent will come from the motor nucleus of the facial nerve, while the fibers for the general visceral efferent, that is the preganglionic parasympathetic fibers, they will come from the lacrimatory nucleus and they will come from the superior, they will be derived from the superior salivatory nucleus. So all these glands which are under the parasympathetic and control of the autonomic nervous system, because facial nerve is supplying that, it is having a component general visceral efferent. Then special visceral afferent component. Now the special visceral afferent is a special visceral afferent, a special sensation, that is the taste sensation. The fibers for this come from the nucleus of tractus solitorius. And general somatic afferent is the last component. It is just for the skin around the external ear. Okay, ultimately the processes of which of the nerve fibers which are supplying these areas, they are going to terminate in the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. So after describing the functional components, which were four, two special, two general, special visceral efferent, general visceral efferent, special visceral afferent, general somatic afferents. Okay. After that, we talk about the various nuclei. Where are the nucleus of the facial nerve situated? The nucleus of the facial nerve is situated in the lower part of the pons. Here we see is the abducens nucleus and here is the facial nerve nucleus and the fibers of the facial nerve nucleus. They take a turn around the abducens nucleus and come out at the junction of pons and medulla. This turning around is called as neurobiotaxis. This turning around is called as neurobiotaxis. So this is the intraneural course. So nucleus of the facial nerve is located at the level of facial calliculus. And facial calliculus is formed by actually abducens nerve nucleus covered by the facial nerve fibers. So there are four nuclei from which the facial nerve derives its fibers. One is the facial nerve nucleus, which is in the lower part of the pons. I'm literally sorry for this. Lower part of the pons, superior salivatory nucleus, lacrimatory nucleus, and nucleus of tractus solitorius. These are the four nucleus: facial nerve nucleus, superior salivatory nucleus, lacrimatory nucleus, and nucleus of tractus solitorius. Now, deep to the facial colliculus. This is the diagram of the floor of the fourth ventricle. We see the facial colliculus, and deep to the facial colliculus is abducens nucleus and the facial nerve. So we see this. This is the facial colliculus. So abducens nucleus and facial nerve fibers running around it. Okay. So intraneural course, the fibers after its origin, they go posteriorly, take a turn around abducens nucleus, then go laterally and anteriorly, they come out through the basal part of pons and medulla. So here we can see the junction pons, this is medulla, this is abducens nerve, and this is the facial nerve. So here is abducens nerve, this is the facial nerve. So appearance on the brainstem at the junction of pons and medulla. So it appears as two roots. Okay, it doesn't just appear as a single facial nerve, but two roots, motor and sensory. The sensory root is also called as nervus intermedius. The sensory is also called as sensory motor because it is sensory as well as it is motor to the glands. Okay, so this now the intracranial course after it comes out of the brainstem. So we started with nuclei, then we talked about intraneural course, then we are now talking about intracranial course. The two roots, they proceed laterally. They enter the internal acoustic meatus along with the eighth nerve and the labyrinthine vessels. Okay. So the next, you must have seen the external acoustic meatus on the external aspect. But then on the internal side, in the posterior cranial fossa, we see the internal acoustic meatus through which the seventh nerve, eighth nerve, and labyrinthine vessels, they enter. Okay. Then there is a course in the facial canal. So in the floor of this internal acoustic meatus is a facial canal where the facial nerve enters, and there are three parts, two bends and one ganglion and three branches which are given in the facial canal. I will show you how it is. And then exit from the skull, it comes out of the stylomastoid foramen. Comes out of the stylomastoid. So this is the course in the facial canal. Okay. I said there are two bends, one and two, and three parts. First part, then one bend where there is geniculate ganglion, then second part, and there are three nerves, greater petrosal, nerve to stapedius and chorda tympani. So from this part to this part up to chorda tympani, greater petrosal to chorda tympani is the part which is there in the facial canal, S shape. Then it comes out and immediately gives three branches, posterior auricular branch, nerve to digastric, nerve to stylohyoid, and then it gives the five terminal branches in the parotid gland. So extracranial course, once it comes out of the stylomastoid foramen, it enters the parotid gland and gives the five terminal branches, temporal, zygomatic, buccal, marginal mandibular, and cervical branch. So extracranial course, it comes out of the stylomastoid foramen, it is lateral to the styloid process, enters the posteromedial surface of the parotid gland, superficial to the retromandibular vein and external carotid artery, and behind, it goes behind the neck of the mandible. Okay. So here we can see how it has started from the facial nerve. It has come down. It has passed through the internal acoustic meatus. Then this is the passage through the facial canal. Then it comes out of the stylomastoid foramen, gives three branches. So three branches in the facial canal, three branches just coming out of stylomastoid foramen, 3 plus 3, 6, and five terminal branches, total 11 branches of the facial nerve. So in the facial canal, it gives three branches, greater petrosal nerve, which joins deep petrosal and supplies the lacrimal gland, nasal and palatal glands, nerve to stapedius and chorda tympani nerve. Chorda tympani supplies the tongue and the submandibular and sublingual gland. Branches, just after exiting the skull, there are three branches, posterior auricular nerve, which supplies the auricular muscle and occipitalis muscle. Nerve to posterior belly of digastric. Anterior belly of digastric is supplied by mandibular nerve, posterior belly by the facial, and nerve to styloid. And then there are terminal branches. temporal, zygomatic, buccal, mandibular, cervical. Okay, so this is how total three branches in the facial canal, three branches after coming out of stylomastoid foramen, and five branches in the parotid gland. So this is how we always write applied anatomy of a nerve. How to test? How does it get paralyzed? What are the effects of paralysis and treatment? So test it by telling the So facial nerve is tested by telling the patient to move the eyebrows, to smile, to blow air, okay, to close the mouth firmly. To approximate the lips very firmly, to close the eyes. So all these muscles of facial expressions are tested. So how it gets paralyzed? There are two ways. One is called as Bell's palsy, which is infranuclear palsy, which happens when facial nerve near the stylomastoid foramen or just inside the stylomastoid foramen due to some inflammation, viral infection, gets paralyzed. And one is supranuclear. So what happens is the facial nerve nucleus, which the part which supplies the upper part of the face, has bilateral representation in the cortex. So whenever the supranuclear paralysis happens, the upper half of the face escapes paralysis because it is represented in the both the cortices. Okay. So effects of paralysis is like mouth will be drawn towards one side. And treatment, Bell's palsy, most of the time heals on its own as the inflammation in the stylomastoid foramen goes down. The Bell's palsy gets pressed. So this is how we describe any cranial nerve. The course, how it appears in the brainstem. Course is intraneural course, then brainstem. Then in case of facial nerve, after brainstem, it goes to the internal acoustic meatus. Then in the facial canal, comes out of the stylomastoid foramen and goes to the parotid gland. So that's all about the facial nerve.